Hi, thanks for the invitation to participate in this virtual conference. Let me introduce myself first. I'm Santiago Elena. I'm a professor at the Spain National Research Council in an institute devoted to evolutionary systems biology. And I'm also an external professor of the Santa Fe Institute, which is a fantastic place for multidisciplinary science. And today I'm going to talk about the evolution of viruses, experimental evolution of viruses in the context of parasitic to mutualistic continuum. My work is on plant viruses, so I have to just make a slide to introduce you how plants deal with stress. Plants, because they are sessile organisms, they don't escape from stresses. They have to deal with everything that happens in their environment. Can be biotic stresses like pathogens, or which can be bacteria, viruses, or fungi, but also abiotic stresses like frost, salinity, cold, heat, or radiation. One of the interesting characteristics of the plant response to stresses is that everything's coordinated by hormonal responses, by different hormones. And the most essential hormone in response is the salicylic acid, the SA. Salicylic acid is central because it is the expression of salicylic acid is triggered by both abiotic and biotic stresses. Salicylic acid interacts with other hormones, like the desmonic and ethylene, which is also involved, if you follow the arrow, is also involved in pathogen response, and also with hormones that have to do with the development of the plant, with the growth of the plant, like the abscisic acid, the auxins, or the gibberellic acid. So there is a very intense crosstalk between hormones in coordinating the response of plants to stress. Okay? Usually, we think in viruses as pathogenic entities. Now, unfortunately, we are facing these very weird, very hard times with the coronavirus, which is a prototypical example of pathogenic virus. But we know that in nature, viruses are not always pathogenic. In many instances, viruses can be also commensals or asymptomatic at least. So in particular in plants, most viral infections are asymptomatic in nature. And this has been described for many years in natural ecosystems. So you can go to the nature, you can sample plants that are apparently healthy, but they contain viruses. And viruses that, in principle, they produce no symptoms at all. That means that most of viruses in plant viruses, at least in nature, they are commensal or even mutualistic. And there is this growing idea that the pathogenic infections in plants result from the highly artificial condition of our artificial ecosystem, from agronomic practices where we have genetically homogeneous hosts, all genetically identical, and then the viruses jump, spill over from the reservoir to the cultivated plants, and then is when you see symptoms and infections. Indeed, there are a few examples already published in the literature where different viruses have been proved to protect the plants against some other stresses. Okay? There are examples of viruses protecting against herbivores by inducing the production of chemical volatiles that the herbivores doesn't like, so they escape from the plants. Or this is one of the best documented examples by the laboratory of Marilyn Rusing in 2008, where they showed that cucumber mosaic virus, here in the picture down, protected beets from drought. So in the left side of the pictures, what you see are beets that have been drought. They have not been irrigated for a while, and they are not infected, and they show strong symptoms of disease or associated to the drought. But if you get the plants infected by cucumber mosaic virus, then the plants look much healthier. In the right panel of the picture, you have a similar experiment done with tobacco mosaic virus. In the upper panel, you see tobacco plants that are drowned in both cases, but on the right side, they are also infected by tobacco mosaic, and clearly the plants look somehow healthier than where they are not infected. And in the bottom pictures, what you have is another example in Nicotiana ventamiana and Genura aurantiaca, where always in the left you have the non-infected plants and in the right you have infected plants. So apparently, infection in these examples are promoting the tolerance of the plant to the desiccation. And several other examples exist, okay, of this type of protection of viruses against pathogen, against drought or salinity or temperature, different examples. Why is this? As I said before, because the response of the plants to several stresses are very interconnected, and by responding to infection, the plant might create a kind of more tolerant situation to other stresses, in this case, drought or salinity or temperature. So it has been hypothesized that the plant-virus interaction should vary within the antagonism-mutualism continuum, where antagonism will be the pathogenic relationship and mutualism will be a tolerant infection that actually favors the plant in some sense, and that whether in this continuum the pathosystem exists in a given time point depends on environmental conditions. This can be illustrated in the following slide here, which is the famous disease triangle, very popular in plant pathology, where in one of the axes of the triangle you have the pathogen genotype. So you have some pathogens that are more virulent, indicated in the red corner, while others are less virulent, indicated on the yellow corner. The host genotype, which is more susceptible in the red corner or more resistant in the green corner. And then you have the third dimension, which corresponds to the environmental factor. Given a certain combination of pathogen genotype, host genotype, and environmental factors, you see the disease. So disease actually is limited to a very, is not occupying the entire space, but is limited to some region of this three-dimensional space. The interesting point here is that if you have a particular combination of parameters and you start changing the environmental factors, so the environmental axis, while keeping constant the pathogen genotype and the host genotype, the situation might evolve towards something that is less and less pathogenic and more on the commensal side. And I repeat it, it's not that I have changed the virus or the host, but just simply changing the virus. This can be framed in the context of a well-known concept in genetics, which is the reaction norm. And here you have an example of reaction norm for plant performance in response to an abiotic factor. In the left panel, the A panel, what you have is an example of how the non-infected reaction norm represented in blue can retain the shape but simply move toward a more extreme intensity of the abiotic factor when the plant is infected. So in blue you will have non-infected plants, in red you will have the case of infected plants. As I say, in panel A you see a complete shift in the position of the optimal and the maximal minimum, but the shape is the same, whereas in panel B is a hypothetical case where you change both the parameters, maximum, minimum, and optimal, but also the shape of the reaction norm. The idea here is just to illustrate by that infection might change the shape or the location of the reaction norms, making the plants infected plants more tolerant to changes in the abiotic stresses, for example, in temperature. So this is the conceptual framework where we are going to be moving. And the question, the scientific question that we are posing and I'm going to discuss with you today is how a change in environmental, in abiotic conditions, in environmental stresses might affect the evolution of a plant virus, okay? The question is, will a virus shift from a parasitic to a commensal or mutualistic relationship in response to environmental changes, or they will not respond to such environmental changes? Okay, that's the question we are going to see today. And our experimental system is a well-studied, well-known experimental system. Sorry. That is represented by the model plant Arabidopsis thaliana. For those of you that are not plant biologists or familiar with plant biology, Arabidopsis thaliana is kind of the battle horse of plant biology. So it's the best known organism among all plants. Okay, we can do all tricks, all genetic tricks. We can do. We have mutants for every gene. The genome is completely sequenced for over 1,000 different genotypes of the plant, natural genotypes. So the amount of information available is really, really amazing. And the virus we're going to use is called turnip mosaic virus, TUMV. And turnip mosaic virus, here you have a skin. This is an electron, it's a colored electron microscopy of the virus. Is one of these filamentous virus that is very simple. Here below you have the genome. The structure of the genome is a single RNA molecule of about 9.5 kb that encodes for a single very long polyprotein that after translation is chopped into the mature peptides by its own proteases. The 27K protease, which is called also known as NIA, and the HCC-Pro protease. Okay, there are two proteases, although the major one is NIA, which is producing most of the peptides. This genetic architecture of a virus is very popular, is very common among RNA viruses, and all the picorna viruses, which include hepatitis C, foot and mouth disease, or polioviruses, they have the same genetic architecture. They belong to the same family, to the same big family than potiviruses, okay? So in some sense, whatever we can learn using plant viruses, to some extent can be, or we hope, can be extended to other viruses that are genetically similar. So TUMV, the turnip mosaic virus, has a moderately narrow range of hosts, which are mostly limited to Brassicaceae. Arabidopsis is a Brassicaceae, but also cauliflowers, broccolis, turnips, all these plants belong to the same family. Turnip mosaic actually is a quite common virus in Arabidopsis, at least in the Iberian Peninsula, which is one of the reservoirs of Arabidopsis diversity in the Northern Hemisphere. Contains a strong prevalence of this virus. So you go outside to the wilds and you sample the plants, you sample Arabidopsis, and it's quite likely that you find turnip mosaic virus. So it's a natural host for this virus. We are not doing nothing really weird, like taking a virus from other host and forcing it to infect Arabidopsis. The only detail, special detail, is that the particular isolate that we use in the lab is came from Calla lily, which is not a brassica, and it is able, still able of replicating in Arabidopsis, although it does worse than some natural isolates of Arabidopsis. And we do that for several reasons that are not actually very relevant for the discussion today. So this is our pathosystem, Arabidopsis thaliana, and turning mosaic potivirus. As I say, Arabidopsis thaliana contains a lot of genetic variability. There are right now more than 1,200 natural accessions, natural ecotypes that have been fully sequenced, and we know a lot of which genes are involved in which functions. In a previous study using another potivirus, very similar to Arabidopsis thaliana, we classified some of these natural accessions according to their response to infection. So these small trees represent the similarity in transcriptomic response to infection with this other potivirus. And basically what we found is that all accessions classify into two groups. One group was what we call group one severe, means that all these accessions actually activate defense genes in the plant. So they produce a strong defense against infection. Whereas there is other type of ecotypes, there's another group of ecotypes that they are not activating defense genes, but what they do is overexpressing metabolism to make the plants more tolerant to infection. Okay, they show less symptoms, they show less necrosis, less dwarfism, and they look better, but simply because they are overexpressing on the metabolism to tolerate infection. Whereas the red group, the group one, some necrosis, some death, and things like that because the strong defense response. Okay, so for our experiment, we decided to select some ecotypes belonging to each one of the groups, to the severe and the mild responses. So we did an evolution experiment, as I mentioned at the beginning, and evolution experiments with plant viruses are really, really simple. General experimental evolution is all about doing passages, bacteria on undefined media, viruses in cell culture, animal viruses in cell culture, I meant, or in the case of plant viruses, simply you inoculate a plant, is here represented by this test tube that contains the virus, you inoculate the plant mechanically, and then you allow the plant to develop symptoms, here represented by the brown leaves, then you collect the tissues that are infected, homogenize, purify the virus, and inoculate another batch of plants and see where the symptoms develop, okay? So this is a very simple experiment. It's not rocket science at all, but still it's a kind of very informative type of experiment. This is the particular experimental design we have used in this study. So we started with ancestral QMB virus, and we designed two independent experiments. In one experiment, this is the standard growth conditions. Plants were watered according to our standard procedures. And the other treatment is the drought conditions treatment, which means that the plants were grown on normal watering until the day of infection. After infection, the plants were not watered anymore. Whereas in the standard conditions, the plants were still watered every day with the corresponding amount of water per volume of soil. Okay, so in blue here you have, in the upper side of the slide, you have the standard condition where the plant, we created three independent evolutionary lineages. Each lineage contained 10 plants, we inoculated 10 plants, we collect the infected tissue of the 10 plants, as I showed you in the previous slide, purify the virus, and then inoculate the next batch of plants. And we did that up to 5 passages, which corresponds to something like 5,000 generations of viral replication, more or less. Okay. In the drought conditions, the design is quite similar, except that the plants remain dry after infection, so there's no water for the plants, okay? But otherwise, everything is the same. 3 independent lineages, 10 plants per lineage, all pulled together after showing symptoms, virus purified, and used to inoculate the next batch of healthy plants, and keep that going on for 5 passages. As I mentioned before, we repeated this experimental design 4 times. For for four different isolates or ecotypes of the plant. Two were of the strong response, Lansbury recta and Stockhorn, and two were of the tolerant response, OIT0 and WT1. Okay, so in total, we have something like 3 × 3 = 6 × 4, 24 different lineages evolving through time. And then on each passage, we quantify the performance of the virus in the way that I will show you in a couple of slides. This is a summary. This is just a picture to show you the results. Basically, what you can see here is how the plants, this is just mock inoculated plants, plants infected with the standard Ebola virus, and plants infected with draw Ebola virus. And as you can see here, there's more green, and the tails and flowers look much healthier than here, although they are not obviously as in the mock inoculated. And here is another of the ecotypes, the ones that show strong symptoms. You can see that there is more tissue, more green tissue here on the left, on the right side, compared to the central panel. And the same is true for the OI. So you see more green tissue, the green yellow tissues than here that are dark and dry and dying. The virus has adapted to each one of the conditions. As you can see, this is a measure of the performance of the virus. It's called the area under the disease progression stair. It's a measure, it's a number that summarizes the speed and dynamics of infection in a single quantity, very popular in plant pathology. And what you can see is that in all cases, the virus has adapted, has increased its fitness, let's say, on a standard and draw condition for all the plant genotypes. And this is perhaps the most important slide in my entire presentation, which is showing you how the ancestral virus or the mock inoculated plants in pink do, how much survival of the plants exists when you have plants that are not infected. Obviously, there are differences among the ecotypes, but basically gives you the baseline to which to compare the infected plants. In blue, you have the plants infected with the virus evolved in standard conditions. As you can see, there is an increase, except in the Lansbury erecta case, there is an increase, a clear increase in highly significant increase in the survival of the plants when infected. And more interestingly, the virus that was evolving on draw select on draw condition further promotes the survival of the plant. And the magnitude of the increase in survival actually depends on the ecotype where the plant has been where the virus has been evolving. This increase in tolerance is not correlated with a decrease in viral accumulation. And this is illustrated on the left panel. As you can see, brown is the draw evolved, blue is the standard evolved virus. They are not different at all in the accumulation. So there is no statistically significant difference in the amount of virus accumulated by the plant. So the effect that we are observing is not because the virus is accumulating less or more, but it's because the virus is doing something different to the plants at the level of what we are going to see in the next few slides, in the level of hormone regulation and gene expression, but not in accumulation of the virus. Usually when you do virus evolution, it's very easy to do next generation sequencing and determine how many mutations you have. And this is just to show you that there are mutations everywhere in the viral genome, but most interestingly, there is a hotspot for mutations with what they call the BPG protein. The BPG protein is a virulence factor. It's well known to interact with the eukaryotic initiation factor that is required by the virus to start transcription of the genome and producing the polyprotein. So this is not new in this study. You can probably see that some mutations are repeating and they are independently arising in different lineages as cases of converging evolution. What is interesting, if you look at this, at all these mutations, and you use this software, which is called SNAP, it gives you a measure, a quantitative measure of the magnitude of the effect of those mutations. And it's interesting to notice that the viruses evolve in standard conditions, in water conditions, they have a much lower effect on average than the mutations that appear in the viruses evolve in drought conditions, okay? That's kind of interesting observation. But what is really more interesting is what is the effect of infection on the plant physiology. So to test that, we have done several experiments. The first experiment was to quantify all the relevant hormones that are involved in response to infection. So we have quantified abscisic acid, what I said before is responsible of growth, jasmonic acid and jasmonic isoleucinetic jasmonic acid, and salicylic acid, which are most important in response to infection, and all the intermediates of other hormones that are relevant. In the top left panel, what you have is the mock inoculated plant, the mock plants. So if we compare the central and the right panel versus the mock panel, tells you how the patterns of hormone expression are changing. In the upper row, you have the standard virus evolving in standard conditions, and in the bottom, you have the virus evolving in drought conditions. This is a quite complex slide, but what I want to show you is that, or highlight here, is that if you compare the axis, the dimension, they completely shift from one case to another. For instance, if you look at ABA, ABA, on the mock, it is on the, basically it's on the left axis, whereas if you move to the standard virus or the world virus, ABA has completely changed to the first quadrant of the panels. The same is true for jasmonic acid. You can see that jasmonic acid was basically over the right positive axis on the mock, and now has slightly moved here on the standard, but dramatically changed on the draw evolved viruses. So you can, if you compare the standard and the evolved, jasmonic acid has dramatically changed the pattern of expression for the standard conditions. If you do the same comparison for the draw conditions, there is no such a big change. So the jasmonic acid or jasmonic isoleucine are always on the kind of on the plus minus quadrant, the fourth quadrant of this plot. Okay, so making the history short, basically what you see here is that the hormones has completely changed the pattern of expression. And what about the genes that are involved in response to infection? This is a summary of the genes that are involved in response to stress. They are basically three different pathways, genetic pathways, involved in stress to draw stress. One is called the ABA-dependent pathway, which is itself divided into branches. The branch A is the protein synthetic dependent, branch B is protein independent, branch C is more related with COL, but is cross-talking with these other two panels, whereas the COL stress is ABA-independent, and also involve a bunch of genes. So downstream, what you have is all the genes and transcription factors that are essential to the response to temperature. So we did a kind of gene-oriented analysis. Basically, we took all these classic genes that are well-described to be involved in response to defense or to stress, and we quantify the expression of all those genes for all our lineages in standard and drought conditions. On the right panel, you have the quantification of all these genes in drought conditions. In the left panel, you have them in the standard conditions. The columns represent the different genes, which are ordered depending on which of the branches in the previous slide are affecting. And in the horizontal, what you have is the different lineages, okay? So one thing you can notice is that the standard evolve always is the above, is is substantially different. The expression of those genes is different in the standard evolved than in the draw evolved. And this is kind of consistent for all the viruses, both in draw and standard conditions. Okay. For instance, you look at the bottom, the WT1, standard evolved, and draw evolved, you see that CYPD-T7, the first gene in the ABA, is highly expressed in the draw, but it's not expressed in the standard, and the same might be true for the P58 IPK transcription factor, which is strongly expressed in draw, but it is not in the standard evolved virus. So there is heterogeneity in the gene, in the expression of the genes that control response to stress. If you don't mind, I'm going to skip this slide. This was just correlating the gene expression of these marker genes with the accumulation of hormones, but it takes a while to explain this slide, and it's not that much information here. So this was our first, this gene-oriented, this gene target approach was just kind of exploratory. We just check the expression of genes that were already well known as involved in resistance to draw, but we took another approach, which is the more general transcriptomic approach, to see how the entire transcriptome of the infected plants varies among conditions, among plants infected with draw, evolve, and ancestral and standard conditions. Basically, what you see here are genes on the left, on the A panel, what you have are the number of genes that are different between draw evolve and standard evolve, mostly the accession that has more changes is OI0 and WT1, the two that are the tolerant plants, actually. And in the C panel, what you have is the biological functions that are being overrepresented on this list of genes. If you want to take a quick look to that, basically on the upper part, what you have is response to salicylic acid, response to regulation of defense, response to viruses, signal transduction, and a bunch of other things that have to do with immunity. And this is specific of the tolerant plant, which are showing these processes, where other processes like metabolism, response to water deprivation, response to abscisic acid are shared between all these viruses. Obviously, the Lansbury recta and Stockholm, there is so few genes that we cannot find any significant category. So to summarize a little bit, this is this last slide where we just want to tell you a summary, a few take-home messages of this presentation is that we have confirmed that infection increased plant tolerance to anabiotic stress, which is drought in our case. Virus, if you evolve a virus under drought conditions, the virus promotes the survival of the plant much in a larger, stronger, in a larger magnitude than the ancestral virus or the virus evolved in permissive conditions. So, and this is done because the virus alters the hormonal signaling in a quite environmental specific manner. So viruses evolve in draw conditions, for instance, affect negatively affect the expression of salicylic and abscisic acids. So they are somehow knocking down their response to infection, and they are somehow knocking down the growth of the plant to make it more tolerant to the stressful environmental conditions. And obviously, all these things depend on which ecotype of the plant we are studying. So there is not a general rule that applies to all the ecotypes, but strongly depends on the particular ecotypes. It is worth noticing that some ecotype Arabidopsis has a wide range of distribution across the northern hemisphere, going from the subarctic regions in the Scandinavian peninsula down to the Iberian peninsula, the north of Africa. So the plants are adapted to very wide thermal draw conditions, and this obviously affects the way the plant responds to abiotic stresses and infection. And finally, under environmental perturbations, in this case, the case we have studied drought, the virus-host interaction can evolve from pathogenic to mutualistic in a relatively short evolutionary time. So for us, it was just 5 passages, which in terms of viral generations is about 5,000, more or less. This is a raw estimate, as I mentioned before. And the last but not the least, the most important slide is who did all this work. Is people from my lab, Ruben and Maria, that are 2 very talented PhD students working on this kind of questions. Paki is our lab engineer that keeps the plants and the growth chambers and everything working, and a set of very smart undergrad students that have been working in the lab for their rotations. And also we have some, we are virologists, we don't know much about plant physiology, so we have to collaborate with the people that understands plant physiology. It's my colleague, Professor Pedro Carrasco at the University of Valencia, and his postdoc, Paco Scaray, and also the people that really knows about plant hormones and quantifies hormones for us, which is my colleague, Aurelio Gómez, that is in the Universitat Jaume I, slightly north from Valencia. And obviously, the money that paid for all this came from the Spanish government, the local government, and my organization, the National Research Council. And that's all. Thank you for your attention, and I'll be really happy to answer any questions that you may have by email. Thanks for all your attention.